Thank you. shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right through. The heathen raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. What desolations he has made in the earth. He made his wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. At this time, we just want to thank all of you on behalf of the family for making this significant effort to be present today to support them. It is unbelievable, and I'm sure that it touches their hearts to know that you have made such a sacrifice. Once again, thank you for being here. The song, Mercy Said No. Mercy said no.
is taken from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 1 through to verse 5. Revelation 21, verse 1 to 5. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Then he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said to me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." Here ends the morning's reading.
Please be seated. We're going to have two tributes at this time. We're going to invite Mr. Daniel O'Neill to go first. He'll be doing a tribute from the son of Sheldon, it's Jonathan, and Mr. Lakshmi Connell. She'll be doing the tribute for the sister of Sheldon, Josephine Graves.
Good morning. This morning I'm going to be reading on behalf of Jonathan. And he says, "My father was a great man, the best person I've ever known. He would always find light and the positive in any situation. He was someone that came to understand life and the importance of living in the moment and making the best of it. My father lived for his family, doing anything possible to make sure that his wife and all four of his children were good. And whatever he could do, physically or financially, which was hardly ever the case, because he would always make a way or find a way. He would make up for it with love and support. I would never forget all the lessons he taught me, all the things he would repeat through our lives. He believed in his work. I remember growing up and seeing my father working 7 days a week, even sometimes on holidays, so much so that my mom would have to beg him to stay home when he would get sick, but he was a provider. And he would always say, "John, I'm fine. As long as my kids are good, I'm good." And that is the definition of a great father and a real man. I also remember being a young teen and asking my dad for money. And unlike my mom, who knew me so good, she would have known that I was probably up to no good. I would ask what I needed it for. I remember asking him and went to him into his wallet and gave me his last $5. No questions asked, because all he knew is his son needed something. And although at the time I was really up to no good, that forever stayed with me, knowing he would always give me his last and seeing someone especially in his family. I pray one day that I become a great father, husband, and friend, a man that you were, Dad. I love you, Dad. I will forever live on. You will forever live on in my heart and my memories. Rest easy, my king, knowing that you did everything best you can, and we appreciate you. To my father, my best friend, I love you. Your son, Jonathan.
Tribute by Josephine Graves, sister of Sheldon. Angels on earth seem to always be taken too soon. We were blessed to have the time we did. I cried so much when I heard of your passing, not even 1 year after our sister Anise passed away. I remember when you shared how much you missed talking to her, and now I feel the same way about you. At least now we have each other. You have each other. As I reflect on our childhood together, memories come flooding back of us doing simple things like washing dishes after supper. As teenagers, we grew even closer. Working together in town meant we would walk to work and eat lunch together. You were my hero and protector, guarding me from all the boys and keeping me out of trouble. You were always such a smart and stylish dresser. I remember your favorite white bell-bottom pants, but you still were kind enough to let me wear them. Who would have known we were one of the first to start unisex clothing in St. Vincent? I felt so proud walking beside my brother, who was so incredibly handsome, kind, and loving. We would always see whose Afro puff could get the biggest. You introduced me to Ebony and Jet magazine, and had me hooked from that point onward. Your love for Kung Fu and Western movies was infectious. My Name is Nobody and The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly were some of your favorites. We would laugh together as you tried to act out the scenes. Too bad I never told you at the time you were in fact my favorite actor. My hope was to surprise you with a visit to Barbados so we could laugh once more, but obviously God had a different plan. We were so close, we even got the same cancer. I fought my cancer battle and I prayed so hard that you would too. Your positive thinking convinced me we would have more time, but God in his infinite wisdom knows best. Goodbye, my brother, and thank you for all the love and laughter. One day I hope to stroll with you in heaven, watching movies and having so much more fun together. Hope it's not too soon. I have yet to meet my grandchildren. You will never be forgotten. You will always be in my heart and cherished memories. Rest in peace, my loving, kind brother. Until we meet again, your life and love was a testimony of the following verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 13. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails, but whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abide of faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love.
I invite you just to bow your heads where you are as we have a special prayer of comfort. Almighty God and Father in heaven, we, your children, gathered here on this day, come before you, Lord, seeking your omnipotence, your omniscience, your omnipresence. For you are all-powerful, all-knowing, and you are always present. Lord, we sorrow at this time. We weep at this time. It's an emotion that you understand. But you have counseled us, God, in your word, not to do it as those who don't have hope. Because we have hope in the coming of our Lord. I ask today, God, that you will hold this family in your loving arms. Give them your peace, because we know the world can't give it. Give them your love, God, because it is unconditional. Give them your grace, because you said it is sufficient in times of need. Soothe their pain in their hearts, even now. Buoy their spirits, I pray. Give them a song. Give them a word. But most of all, Father, give them you. Thank you for your presence here with us, and thank you for your comfort. Thank you for your promise that you will never leave. You will never forsake us. This be our prayer today on their behalf. In Jesus' name, amen.
A blessed good morning to all of you. The next song that we will be singing is the song Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. We're going to have some accompaniment by music. I understand it's a little faster than usual, but I'm quite sure you'll do well. Let us all stand, please.
A fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on everlasting.
You may be seated. Okay, thanks. Okay, We have two additional tributes by friends. So we're going to ask them to prepare themselves, and the first one can come at this time to share these tributes.
Thank you. Okay. All right, so go ahead. Hi, good morning, everyone. I tribute to Sheldon Graves from our family and friends. We have known Sheldon for a very long time. That would be about over 40 years. I've known him to be hardworking, genuine, and kind friend, very family oriented, a loving husband, and a caring father. We've shared many memorable moments, some challenging, and we had lots of fun times. Cricket, picnic, family gatherings. He loved to lime and was always warm and welcoming on the occasions when we met at his house. I must add that when he married Wina, the liming intensified. She being a trainee and all, that liming never stopped. On these occasions we came together, we love to refer to our group as the CSME group, because there was Vincentian, Trinidadian, St. Lucian, Bajan. And the odd time we would sometimes, somebody else from another Caribbean island would join us as well. He was always a very positive person. He approached his day-to-day life in that manner as well. When he became ill, that positive outlook on life really helped him through the difficult times. I will use such words as kind, genuine, meticulous, and humble to describe my friend, our friend. And somehow I know he's resting in peace, knowing that because of the type of person he was and the persons he attracted to him as a result of his attributes, his family has been left in very good hands. We love you, Sheldon, and we'll always remember you.
Good morning, everyone. When we think of Sheldon, what readily comes to mind is one of the most meticulous, orderly spirits you could encounter. Who could forget the precision with which Sheldon parked a vehicle, or packed a picnic basket for cricket, or precisely cubed the beef when assisting Wina in preparing rotis? But I think a special mention should be made of the attention he paid to his dogs, whom he ensured were always well-groomed, much like himself. Not to forget the dog house, which was built by his very own hands, beautifully crafted and color-coordinated and spotless at all times. The other adjective that readily comes to mind when I think of Sheldon, or when we think of Sheldon, is dramatic. He could tell a story that rivaled Paul Keynes Douglas on his best day, guaranteed to make you belly it with laughter. Our favorite Sheldon story is one of our dear friend Ron playing football with the children and having the misfortune to fall in the presence of Sheldon and the children. Lights, action, camera. Sheldon gave the blow-by-blow account of the episode, including the fall, much to the chagrin of Ron every time he retold the story. Sheldon's favorite part was the comment to him by the children, "Daddy, we didn't know that big people could fall down." Such wonderful memories of a dear friend, gone too soon, but living in our hearts forever. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Love you always, Ron, Phyllis, June, Leroy, and Lizzie. Thank you.
Thank you for those tributes. And we want to invite Terry Warren to do the eulogy at this time. Thank you.
Let me say a blessed good morning to everyone. I just want to share one single thing about my good friend and neighbor Sheldon. One Christmas week I came home and on his lawn, he had some white angels and reindeers and stuff. Pretty with lights. And the next day, somebody said, but Sheldon, you know these things in town cost about $300 and something. He said, you know, man, but I went and looked at them. I came back and got the wire. And I made these angels, the angels and everything that was his lawn, I mean, was just perfect. He had a very creative mind. I would not go any further concerning the food and all of the drinks that I enjoy in his presence and his family. But I just want to thank God for him and for the many memories that he would have left with all of us. And I just want you to listen carefully to this tribute. Thank you to everyone with us here in person and those joining virtually from around the globe in celebrating the life of Sheldon Sylvester Graves. Sheldon was a man of strong faith. He viewed life through such a beautiful and positive frame. Most of us would agree. Sheldon was quite a talker. In this very moment, he must be sharing his many stories with all those around him. With Sheldon, you never had to question his love, his family devotion, integrity, and most of all, the value he held about living life with purpose, passion, and hard work, much like his father, Papa. What a wonderful picture it would be to see the embrace between him and his late mother and father, the Greys, his late brother Jeffrey, and sister Anise, reunited once again. Sheldon was always the peacemaker, negotiator, and stylish chef, cooking all those family Christmas meals and memories we share together in St. Vincent. I must dare say here too that even though I was not in St. Vincent, that I definitely, my wife and I, and some of our neighbors enjoy some of those same meals here in Barbados. He would always look at the beauty in the midst of darkness, giving hope, encouragement, and appreciation for all things. We all know appreciate was one of his favorite words. Sheldon was born on July 28, 1957, in Dorsetshire Hill, St. Vincent. He was a loving husband to his wife, Veronica Vena Graves, children and grandchildren, Letitia and family, Shane and family, Jolene and Jonathan. He was the fourth child of Celestine and Lloyd Graves. His sisters and brothers are Violet, Frank, Edna, Josephine, Andrew, Von Lee, Beverly, Stanford, and Raquel. As a child, Sheldon has had an unsatisfiable sweet tooth. His older siblings would reminisce of times their grandfather would visit the butcher every Saturday morning and often bring in his grandchildren a sweet treat, a piece of cake called slice in those days. Sheldon was always the first to run to his grandfather asking if he bought him a slice. You can always rely on Vincentians to find the humor in every situation, and slice became a nickname that would follow Sheldon for the rest of his life. In 1980, Sheldon moved to Barbados. He worked outside the airport for many years, taxiing and being the first familiar face greeting many. He took pride in showing off the natural beauty of his second home, Barbados. He developed many connections that grew into life friendships among many of you here today. Sheldon personally exuded a divine kindness and sincerity, one that would draw you in wholeheartedly. In his last years, he finally achieved what many others will never find, a place of peace and tranquility, minus the monkey stories that would make you laugh until you cry, or as the Caribbean people would say, until your belly busts. Sheldon was such an animated storyteller and would share his wisdom and unshakable Christian faith. The Bible was his fortress, his strength, and his teacher. Sheldon gave thanks and glory to God for all things, even in those dark days undergoing his treatment. Now it is your time to finally rest for the life well lived. This is a hard loss to grieve, coming much sooner than we thought. But let us seek comfort and remember the incredible man, husband, father, grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend. He exemplified to us all. So let us continue his legacy of humility, positivity, kindness, and valor. Thank you.
Thank you as well, Mr. Warren. To bring the word of God to you is Pastor Jamil Blackman. He's currently pastoring the Chance Hall, Northern Light, and Cave Hill Seventh-day Adventist churches, all in St. Lucie. He's been pastoring for the past 7 to 8 years and is a close friend of the family. Let us welcome Pastor Jamil. And I see here we have sermonette, but I do hope that we have a sermon, because sermonette, as they say, bring Christianettes. So, the word of God, sir.
Again, good morning to everyone. It's a privilege to share with you a few words. My friend, he taught me a lot. And today I know I'm gonna pour out my heart, because he left so many things on my heart, even to share with others. The reason I believe you're here is because he would have touched your life at some point. And even as a pastor, he would still touch mine. To always meet someone who knows the word, to encourage you in the Lord, is always a good thing. And so bear with me today. I hope that I can hold back myself. But we know how things go sometimes. So the family, enough love. On behalf of Mona and I, we are with you. I've decided to title the message today, Pages Worth Reading. Pages Worth Reading. Bow your heads as we pray. Lord, again we come. I come. Anoint me afresh. Touch my entire being, but most of all, God, touch my lips and my tongue. May I represent you, O God, even to those of us who are here, in Jesus' name. I read a quotation recently which said, "Life is full of amazing chapters, ups and downs, good and bad." But it said, "Remember that you'll never be able to move forward if you keep rereading the last chapter over and over." And I'm sure we're all familiar with the expression, take a page from someone's book. It means to do something in the way someone else would do it, or behave, or even to act like that person. Today I've come by to share with you for the next few moments under the caption, Pages Worth Reading. The Bible says in Romans 14, 19, "Therefore let us pursue the things which make for peace, and the things by which one may edify another." This life that we live should not be characterized by strife and contention, by quarreling and commotion. But Paul says focus should be on that which seeks to bring about peace, praise God, and helps us to build each other up. So permit me today to share a few pages from Sheldon's book. I wouldn't be able to share all, but let me share just a few which I believe are beneficial to us. St. Matthew's Gospel gives an account of Jesus in a discourse asking those in the hearing of his voice a serious question. Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to your stature? Because the same word for stature can be used in speaking about age, another version says, can any of you, by worrying, add a single moment to your lifespan? I concluded, if worrying could make us taller, a lot of us would be giants. If worrying could extend our life, some of us would be hundreds of years old by now. I can almost hear Sheldon saying, "That's it. Tell me what you're worrying about. Tell me what you're worrying for. It don't make sense." Jesus concluded this point by saying, "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for today is its own trouble." You see, too many people permit themselves to be haunted by the ghost of tomorrow even before tomorrow can present itself. You can look forward to tomorrow, no problem with that. You can plan for tomorrow. You can imagine about tomorrow, but you may never experience tomorrow. So why worry? Tell me, the song says, why worry when you can pray? The songwriter says, many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand. But I know who holds, hallelujah, tomorrow. And I know who holds my hand. And so in a prayer of Moses found in Psalm 90 verse 12, Moses says, "So teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom." In other words, we need to meditate on life's brevity, that we may be wise in employing the time that God allots to us. Let me make this clear. To every one of us, we have a time allotted. And it makes perfect sense to make best use of the time that you have been allotted, because you may speak about tomorrow, but you don't know if you will see tomorrow. So why worry? But number your days, that you may know how to apply the time that you have wisely. For each of us, we have an allotted time on earth. What we do with it matters to God. Sometimes we spend so much time tearing each other down than focusing on building each other up. I'm talking about pages from Sheldon's book. I got this experience firsthand. One day, just let me let you tell you a story. One day, I think Jolie Lay, I visited her. I think she was at work. Dad had to do therapy. She wasn't sure what time it would end. I said, Joe, don't worry. If he has to go early, I'll take him. Not knowing what position God was putting me in, I saw a man. Challenges in life. Battling for life. But yet still sitting down and encouraging all the other patients. Huh? Sitting and talking with everybody, giving them hope and encouraging everyone. And everyone that left that place knew who Sheldon was. If they came out of the doctor's office, all right, Sheldon, see you. Take care, man. Things are going to be good. A man's life who is devoted to encouraging others and letting them know that all will be well. This is a page that I have taken from Sheldon's book. He kept a smile on their faces. It's hard when you have to go to QEH. I don't know how many of you have been there. Whether to visit or because you needed treatment, but whichever one, it's hard. But to be able to keep a smile on persons, it's a gift from God. I've taken that page. In this experience, I learned some valuable lessons. Everyone may not be at the same point in their journey. We all deal with our situations differently. The journey may come to an end quicker for some than for others. Life's book is longer for some than for others. But at the end of the day, if we're all walking with God, we will reach the same destination. Are you listening to me today? If we are walking with God, we will all reach the same destination. I may live longer than you, but if we are walking with God, we will reach the same destination. I may deal with my challenges different to you, but if I am walking with the same God that you are walking with, we will get there together. And so Paul says, if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. Hallelujah. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Hallelujah. So don't think that because he is asleep that he gone before you. We are walking with God. It is just a pause, but we will get there together. For the next verse says, we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus shall we always be with our Lord. But hear what Paul says. Hear what Paul says. The final verse. Hear what he says. Therefore, comfort. Build someone up. Lift someone up. Keep their countenance up. Comfort someone with these words. That brings me to my third page. I just want to share three with you. Very often in our conversations, Whether it was about his garden, which we know he loved. I never saw someone so meticulous about grass. Y'all know who I'm talking about, you know. We get all excited about flowers and the colors and what we can grow that can we can eat afterwards and that which will bear fruit, and we get all excited about that, but this man, I got a lesson as to which grass is good grass, which grass you need to take out because it's going to choke the other grass, but you want this type of grass. Huh? Whether it was about his animals, someone spoke about that, especially the ones that would gravitate to his home. Whether it was about the adjusting to life's changing scenes, even during the time he allowed me to cut his hair. Boy, I don't even know if he knew what he was doing. Thank God I had a little practice before. He would be so dumbstruck as to how a person could say there is no God. Then he would always say, well, you know the Bible say, a fool saith in his heart, there is no God. What's interesting about that particular line is that it is mentioned twice in the Psalms. Psalm 14 and Psalm 53. As a matter of fact, the verse is mentioned twice. And even more important, the psalm is repeated twice. So if you read Psalm 14 and you read Psalm 53, you'll get the same message. Why would the psalmist repeat the same thing again? Enough blows in my backside tells me that if something is repeated, it serves for emphasis, right? I learned that the hard way. You know, mom can repeat things over and over. Can spend a week telling you about it and you don't hear, or she emphasizes it another way. Here it is, the psalmist is repeating this thing. It serves as a reminder. Be careful not to be caught in the same trap. Listen to what I'm telling you. Do not get caught up with the theories of men which denounce the existence of God. Sheldon knew there must be a God. Huh? Let me tell you how else would things grow in my garden that people say can't grow? Some things I see him growing up there, I say, how do you get these things growing in your... There must be a God. There must be a God because I told him I wanted a sheep. I came outside and found a sheep outside. You listening to me? They're not lying to you. You know, if you want, you just ask them to come by a day, you'll see the sheep pen. There must be a God. I told him I would love a beehive. I'm sure if you want to go to see that one, but bees came. Found a place to live by the house. Huh? You think that I'm lying? Ask them to come by and see it. Don't go too close. There must be a God, for with no money in my pocket, there's food on my table. There must be a God because when there was no way, he found a way. There must be a God. He paid my way when there was no other way. There must be a God because if there was not a God, he would not have saved my soul. Paul puts it this way to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15. I'm paraphrasing. If there is no God, then Christ is not raised, and we are all false witnesses. If Christ is not raised from the dead, then we are dead in our sins. If we are dead in our sins, then there is no hope. And if there is no hope, why are you asking me to preach?
our preaching is in vain. Paul says, if this is the life you prefer to live with without God, it's a miserable life. However, I know there is a God. Paul says, for I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God, Paul says. But by the grace of God, he says, I am what I am. And his grace towards me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which is in me. You see, I know who I was. You may not know. Joe may have a little idea because she went to university with me. But she don't know the full scope. But I know who I was. If you happen to meet a lady by the name of Jennifer Antoinette Blackman, she will tell you who I was. She'll let you know what you're seeing here today is the grace of God. Trust me. But I know who I am today because someone rescued this sin-sick soul. Someone rescued this rebellious child. Someone said, mercy. What a page. Therefore, Paul says, I want to show you a mystery. Here's the mystery. We shall not all sleep. We shall be changed. In a moment, coming to an end, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised incorruptible and we shall be changed. This corruptible must put on incorruption. This mortal must put on immortality. When this corruptible hath put on incorruption, this mortal put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying, death is swallowed up in victory. No death. Where's your sting? Huh? You're stinging us all the time. Death, where's your sting? You stung the grave's family. But when Jesus comes, death, where's your sting? Grave, where's your victory? Sting of death. Is sin, and the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. This same God revealed his plan in John, and he said in our scripture reading, there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. He said, he's going to wipe every tear from your eye. No more pain. No more crying. No more sorrow. Hallelujah, death itself shall die. For these words are true and faithful. These three pages out of many are worth reading. I know there are lots more that you can probably think of, but the truth is you must continue now to write your own book. Sheldon's book is closed, but our books are still open. What are we writing today? Someone is depending upon you and me to have and to read some pages that are worth reading. Therefore, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just,
Whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, come on, think. It's so easy to think about the negative, so easy to think about the bad. But if it is praiseworthy, please, think about these things. Thank you, God, for your word today. Thank you for your inspiration today. As this family lives and moves now, carry them, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Song Nobody Greater by Vashon Michel. So we play at this time. Okay, because of time constraints, we will go straight to the last song, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. Thank you.
For as much as God, in his goodness and the outworking of his providence, has permitted our friend, father, uncle, grandfather, husband, Sheldon Graves, to lay down the burdens of his life, we do lovingly commit this body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, remembering as we do
that all the issues of life are in the hands of the everlasting Father, who is a Father of love and compassion, and that he has promised eternal life to all those who love him. May his soul rest in peace. Amen. Remain standing with your heads bowed. We will have our prayer of commitment. And even as we exit, we will sing that song. That song will be played when nobody greater as we exit. Thank you.
Father, we give you thanks, God, for your goodness towards us. As we come to you at this time, mighty God, we recognize, Lord God, that in these moments, the only sure arms are your arms. The only calming voice is your voice. The only reassuring presence is your presence. Father, we pray then that your voice, your presence, and your arms will be with Sheldon's family, his wife, Vina, his children, Lord God, grandchildren. We pray, mighty God, that you will touch the entire family, Lord God. I pray, God, that your grace, which is always sufficient, will be proven correct, O God, in these coming days. Lord God, I pray that when the emptiness left by his departure is weighing too heavily upon them, it is my prayer, God, that your presence will fill the void. You declared in your word, God, that weeping will endure, but it will come to an end, and that joy will come in the morning. I pray for morning time, an extended morning time for this family. Lord God, may the graciousness and the kindness and the life that he lived here resonate throughout their lives, Lord God, as points and as places, O God, of reassurance and comfort and of joy. Bless them, I pray, God, for only you can do it the way it needs to be done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you, and thank you for your presence here.
Nobody greater than you. See clearly.